Hi, can you please tell me about your experience with Java development and how many years you've been working with it?
Sure thing. I have been working with Java for 5 years now, and I really enjoy using it. It's a very powerful and versatile language that's well-suited for a wide range of applications. I've used it for both web development and back-end development, and I'm confident in my ability to work with any Java framework or library. Is there anything in particular about Java that you'd like me to expand on?
Can you explain your proficiency level in SQL and how you've used it in your previous projects or roles?
Sure, I would consider myself a proficient SQL user. I've used it extensively in my previous roles, particularly for writing queries and creating databases. I'm familiar with a variety of SQL dialects, such as MySQL, PostgreSQL, and Microsoft SQL Server. I've used it for data analysis, reporting, and data manipulation tasks. Do you have any specific questions about my experience with SQL, or any particular databases or use cases?
Can you tell me about your experience with GCP and any specific GCP services or projects you've worked on?
Absolutely. I have a good amount of experience with GCP, particularly with services like Google BigQuery, Google Cloud Storage, Google Compute Engine, and Google Kubernetes Engine. I've used GCP to build and deploy web applications, set up and maintain cloud infrastructure, and manage data pipelines and analytics workloads. I'm really comfortable working with GCP, and I'm always excited to learn about new services and features. Have you got any particular areas of GCP that you'd like me to discuss further?
Can you share an example of a challenging client interaction you've had in the past and how you handle
it? That's a really great question. There have been a few situations in my career where I've had to deal with challenging clients, but I can think of one in particular that stands out. I was working with a client who had very specific and stringent requirements, and they were not very communicative or responsive. I found that being proactive and persistent was the key to dealing with them. I would reach out to them regularly and try to get clarification on their needs, and I made sure to document all of our interactions. In the end, we were able to meet their requirements and complete the project successfully. Absolutely. I approach documentation with a few key principles. First, I try to be as clear and concise as possible, without sacrificing detail. Second, I try to create documentation in a way that's easily accessible and searchable for my team members. I often use a shared document platform like Google Docs or Confluence to make it easy to access and collaborate on the documentation. Lastly, I make sure to update documentation as needed as the project evolves. I think that creating clear and up-to-date documentation is crucial to the success of any project.
Can you discuss your approach to documentation and how you ensure it's effectively maintained in your projects?
Absolutely. I can think of a recent project where I collaborated with a team of engineers, architects, and product managers to develop a new software feature. I was responsible for leading the design of the user interface and coordinating with the engineers to ensure that the design was feasible and efficient. I also worked closely with the product managers to ensure that the feature met the business requirements. By working closely with the entire team, we were able to deliver a high-quality feature that met all of the requirements and was well-received by users.
The job description mentions JUnit for Mockito. Can you discuss your experience with these frameworks and how you've used them in your previous work?
Of course. I've worked extensively with JUnit 4 and Mockito in my previous work, and I'm very comfortable using them. I've used JUnit 4 to write unit tests for Java code, and I've used Mockito to create mock objects and stubs to test code in isolation. I find these frameworks to be very powerful and easy to use, and I think they're an essential part of any Java developer's toolkit.
Can you provide some details about your most recent Java development projects or roles to demonstrate your experience in this area?
Sure thing. In my most recent role, I worked as a Java developer for a fintech company where I was responsible for developing and maintaining several Java applications. One of my main responsibilities was to maintain and enhance a Java-based payment processing system that handled millions of transactions per day. I also worked on a Java-based microservices-based system that was used to handle data analytics for the company. Overall, I have more than 5 years of experience working with Java, and I'm very comfortable with the language and its ecosystem.
Can you provide an example of a situation where you had to manage multiple tasks simultaneously and how you ensured everything was completed on time with quality?
Definitely. In my last role, I had to juggle several tasks at once, including bug fixes, feature development, and code reviews. I used a combination of tools and processes to help me manage my time and prioritize my tasks. For example, I used a Kanban board to visualize my tasks and prioritize them according to their urgency and importance. I also set aside specific time each day to focus on my most important tasks, and I made sure to communicate with my team and stakeholders regularly to keep everyone updated on my progress. In the end, I was able to complete all of my tasks on time and with high quality.
Explain the difference between checked exceptions and unchecked exceptions in Java, and provide an example of each.
Yes, absolutely. In Java, checked exceptions are exceptions that the Java compiler checks for, and they must be explicitly handled by the developer. Unchecked exceptions, on the other hand, are not checked by the compiler and can occur at any time. For example, a checked exception would be something like a file not found exception, which is thrown when a file can't be found. This is a checked exception because it's predictable and can be handled by the developer. An unchecked exception would be something like an out-of-memory error, which is an error that occurs when the Java Virtual Machine, JVM, runs out of memory.
Can you explain the concept of multi-threading in Java, including how it works and why it's important?
Absolutely. Multi-threading is a way to run multiple threads or tasks concurrently within a single Java program. This is achieved by using the Java Thread class and the Java Runtime Environment, JRE, thread scheduler. Multi-threading is important in concurrent programming because it allows multiple tasks to run at the same time, which can improve the performance of the program. An example of where I've used multi-threading is in a web application I worked on, where I used multi-threading to process requests from multiple users concurrently. This allowed the application to handle more requests per second and provide a better user experience.
Can you explain the concept of Java generics, how they work, and provide an example of how you've used generics in your code to enhance type safety and code reusability?
Sure thing. In Java, generics are a way to make code more type safe and reusable. With generics, you can define a generic type parameter, which can be used to create generic classes, methods, and interfaces. A simple example would be a generic list class, which can be used to store any type of object, such as integers, strings, or even other objects. The list class would then be able to perform generic operations, like adding or removing items from the list, without having to know the specific type of the objects being stored in the list.
Let's discuss another advanced Java concept, Java serialization. Can you explain what Java serialization is, how it works, and why it's important in Java development? Additionally, provide an example of a situation where you've used Java serialization.
Absolutely. In Java, serialization is a mechanism for persisting an object's state so that it can be restored at a later time. This is accomplished by converting the object into a stream of bytes that can be stored or transmitted. Java serialization is useful for situations where you need to store or transmit complex objects, or when you need to restore the state of an object after a crash or restart. An example of where I've used Java serialization is in a web application that stored user data in a database.
Can you discuss your familiarity with containerization technologies, such as Docker, and how you've used them in conjunction with GCP to deploy and manage applications efficiently?
Yes, of course. In my experience, I've found containerization technologies like Docker to be extremely useful for creating portable, self-contained applications that can be easily deployed and managed. With Docker, you can package all the dependencies and configuration of an application into a container image, which can then be deployed on GCP with tools like Google Kubernetes Engine, GKE. This provides a lot of benefits, including faster deployment times, easier scaling, and better fault tolerance. I've used these technologies to create scalable, reliable applications that are easy to maintain.
Can you explain the principles of microservices architecture and how it differs from a monolithic architecture? Additionally, provide an example of a project where you've implemented microservices on GCP or a similar cloud platform.
Absolutely, I'd love to. Microservices architecture is a software development approach that decomposes a large, complex application into a collection of small, independent services. Each microservice is designed to perform a specific, well-defined task and is loosely coupled with the other services in the system. This architecture is different from a monolithic architecture, where all the functionality of an application is contained in a single, large program. A microservices architecture provides benefits like better scalability, more fault tolerance, and easier maintenance.
Can you elaborate on how you've used Google BigQuery, one of the GCP services mentioned, and its significance in handling large-scale data analytics tasks? Additionally, provide an example of a project where you leveraged Google BigQuery for data ANA.
I'd be happy to. Google BigQuery is a serverless, scalable data warehouse service that can quickly analyze large data sets. With BigQuery, you can query data using standard SQL or BigQuery's specialized SQL dialect, and the results are returned in seconds. It's also possible to load and transform data using familiar tools like SQL, R, and Python. A key advantage of BigQuery is that it's highly scalable, so you can handle large amounts of data without worrying about infrastructure management. I've used BigQuery to analyze large data sets and create reports and dashboards for clients.
Can you explain the differences between the SQL join types, such as inner join, left join, right join, and full join? Provide examples of scenarios where you would use each type of join in a database query.
Sure, let's start with the inner join, which returns the rows that exist in both tables. The left join returns all the rows from the left table and the matching rows from the right table. The right join returns all the rows from the right table and the matching rows from the left table. Finally, the full join returns all rows that exist in either table. Each type of join is useful for different purposes. For example, if you want to find all the customers who have placed an order, you would use an inner join.
Can you explain the concept of database indexing, the types of indexes commonly used in SQL databases, and the benefits of using indexes in database design? Additionally, provide an example of a situation where you've optimized a database query using...
Yes, I'm happy to explain database indexing. In short, indexing is a technique used to improve the performance of SQL queries by providing a way to quickly find the records that match a query. There are different types of indexes, such as B-tree indexes and hash indexes. B-tree indexes are the most common type, and they store the values of a column in a tree-like structure. Hash indexes, on the other hand, use a hash function to quickly find records that match a query. Indexing can significantly improve the performance of SQL queries, especially on large datasets.
Can you discuss the Java Collections framework, including the main interfaces and classes it consists of, and how you've used collections in your Java projects to manage and manipulate data efficiently?
Yes, the Java Collections framework is a very important part of the Java programming language, and I have used it extensively. The framework consists of several key interfaces and classes, such as the collection interface, which defines the basic functionality for all collections, and the list, map, and set interfaces, which define the behavior of specific collection types. The framework also includes classes like ArrayList, HashMap, and HashSet, which implement the various interfaces and provide useful functionality. I have used all of these classes to create efficient data structures that allow me to manipulate and manage data in my Java projects.
Can you discuss your familiarity with Google Cloud Spanner, one of the nice-to-have technologies mentioned in the job posting, and how it differs from other GCP database services like Cloud SQL? Additionally, provide an example of a project where why.
Absolutely. So, Google Cloud Spanner is a distributed relational database service that's designed for large-scale global applications. It's different from other GCP database services like Cloud SQL in a few key ways. First, Cloud Spanner is a fully managed service, which means that Google takes care of all the infrastructure and maintenance for you. Second, Cloud Spanner is a globally distributed database, which means that it can scale across multiple regions and provides low latency access to data from anywhere in the world. Finally, Cloud Spanner is highly available and durable, with built-in features like automatic failover and replication.
Let's shift our focus to microservices architecture. Can you explain how you've implemented load balancing and service discovery in a microservices-based application, particularly within a GCP environment, to ensure the scalability and reliability of?
Yes, I'm happy to explain how I've implemented these concepts. For load balancing, I've used GCP's internal load balancing and external load balancing services. These services allow you to distribute traffic across multiple instances of a service, and they provide features like health checks and auto-scaling. For service discovery, I've used GCP's service registry and service proxy services. These services allow you to discover and call services by their name rather than their underlying IP address, which makes your system more flexible and resilient.
Can you explain the concept of Java annotations, how they are used in Java development, and provide an example of a custom annotation you've created or used in a project to enhance code functionality or documentation?
Absolutely. Java annotations are a powerful feature that allow you to add metadata to your code without affecting its behavior. Annotations can be used for a variety of purposes, including code documentation, dependency injection, and aspect-oriented programming. One example of a custom annotation I've created is a IValidate annotation that I use to validate input parameters for a web service. This annotation helped to make the service more robust and easier to maintain, as it eliminated the need for manual validation code.
Can you discuss your familiarity with Google Kubernetes Engine, GKE, and how you've used it to deploy and manage containerized applications? Additionally, provide an example of a project where you've leveraged GKE for container orchestration and scale.
Yes, I have extensive experience with GKE. In short, GKE is a managed service for running containerized applications on GCP, and it allows you to easily deploy and manage your applications on a cluster of virtual machines. It also provides features like auto-scaling, rolling updates, and monitoring. For example, I used GKE to deploy a large-scale microservices application that consisted of dozens of containers. Thank you for the opportunity to discuss my technical knowledge and experience. I look forward to participating in the next round of the interview process and demonstrating my skills and expertise in more depth. I appreciate the chance to learn more about your company and the role. I am excited to see where this journey takes us. Thank you again for your time. It's been a pleasure chatting with you. Good luck with your hiring process.